Hello everyone, welcome to today's church service. Good to have you again with us for yet another Sunday of worshipping God together. And today is a special Sunday because it's Mother's Day. So happy Mother's Day to all mothers, grandmothers and spiritual mothers out there who have relentlessly poured out your love and your lives all these years in the growth of your families, the community and the church. So we thank you and we love you and we appreciate you. So let's just take some time now, if you are with your moms or your grandmothers, to give them a hug, a kiss, and just thank them, and let's just take this time to appreciate them. Show them how much you love them, and just give them a word of encouragement. Alright, let's prepare our hearts to worship God together, though we may be physically apart. But spiritually, we are united in Jesus Christ. So let's worship God together.
race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Shadows in the light of you.
worship you. I worship you. The reason I live is to worship you. I worship you. Today's scripture reading is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5, 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 14 to 17, and John chapter 15 verses 4 to 8. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Louise and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 to 17. Verse 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. John chapter 15, verses 4 to 8. Verse 4. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ, and all who are worshipping at home with us. Today is Mother's Day, and on behalf of the church, we would like to wish all mothers, grandmothers, spiritual mothers and grandmothers, and mothers to be a blessed Mother's Day. We may all be celebrating Mother's Day differently, but all celebrations will surely be at home because we are all still under CMCO. We are living in unprecedented, challenging times. Since almost 2 months ago, because of the pandemic of the COVID-19 virus, the world has gone back to basics. There has been no air, sea, rail, and even road travel for the past 2 months until recently. Churches have gone back to basics in worshipping at homes, as what the early church did during the first and second centuries because of persecution.
families have gone back to basics with parents working from the home and children schooling at home and therefore having more family time. I have chosen the sermon title, Back to Basics, as a reminder of our basic role as disciple makers for Christ in the family. Today's message is not meant just for mothers, but fathers as well. After all, the father is the spiritual head of the family. So fathers, please don't fall asleep. What I chose to speak on is in line with our church vision for 2020 to 2022, to be a disciple-making family church after God's own heart. Epo Wesley formed a family ministry task force in September last year to propose changes to promote family discipleship in the home and church. Ben Frodenberg, author of Family Friendly Church, said, "Parents are the primary educators in the church, and the family is the God-ordained institution for faith building in children and youth, and for the passing of faith from one generation to the next." He told an interesting story in his book in the introduction, and I'm going to share this story with you. A dying father told his pregnant wife, "I don't care what name you give to my son, but promise me this, that you tell him about Jesus. Teach him well, so someday I'll be able to meet my son in heaven." The mother kept her promise and took her son to be baptized and faithfully taught him about Jesus. She took him to church and Sunday school every week and enrolled him in a Christian school. She taught him by example what it meant to give part of his money to the Lord's work and the importance of daily Bible reading, devotion, and service. She taught him to pray and she modeled her love and passion for God to him. Through the power of the Holy Spirit and the mother's active participation in nurturing the son's faith, his love for Jesus grew and flourished. He loves and willingly serves Christ and know he will someday meet his Father in heaven. This story illustrates how important it is for a mother to be disciple-making, to participate in disciple-making at home, especially when the father is not there. Using the examples of Louis and Eunice, the grandmother and mother of Timothy, as what we have heard from the scripture passage read to us, we realize how important the role of the mother is, especially when there is evidence of a missing father or unbelieving father for various reasons. Timothy's father was a Greek Gentile, assumed to be a non-believer. Eunice was Jewish. Louis and Eunice are biblical examples of the powerful influence a mother or grandmother can have on a young person's life. Other examples who will be mentioned in today's message are mothers of famous godly men like Billy Graham, Charles Spurgeon, and John Wesley. In 2 Timothy 1:5, Paul described the faith of Louis and Eunice as sincere. What is a sincere faith? A sincere faith is a genuine faith, and a genuine faith is connecting, convincing, and contagious. Firstly, we will look at what is a connecting faith. A connecting faith requires abiding and remaining in Christ in a personal relationship. As in John 15:4 read to us, Jesus said, "Remain in me as I also remain in you." Like all human relationships, there are no shortcuts to develop a closer, deeper relationship with one another. Whether between a girlfriend and a boyfriend, husband and wife, a parent-child, a team leader and team members, and a pastor and his sheep, we need to invest time and effort in growing a relationship, no matter how busy we may be at home or at work. With the recent MCO, time was everyone's greatest commodity, which was previously the opposite. I pray and hope that some of us, if not all of us, would have deepened our relationship with God with prayer and reading and study of His Word during MCO. A connecting faith also requires perseverance to know and obey God's word. In John 8:31, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples." When you hold on to something, you do not let go. We must constantly be reading, believing, and obeying God's word. Sunday sermons are not enough. During the week, if we are to continue or persevere in knowing God's word, we can do personal devotions or join a small group. You can talk to Mr. Raymond Tan, our small group coordinator. Or you can join the Ladies Bible Study Fellowship. You can talk to our pastor's wife, Mrs. Dorcas Ong. Or when Christian education courses are being conducted by our Christian education chair lady, Mrs. Kong Abun, you can also participate in that. And for pre-believers and new believers to know more about Christianity, you can see Reverend Timothy about baptism and membership classes. A connecting faith requires dependence on God. John 15:5, Jesus said, "Apart from me, you can do nothing." Only when we are connected to God in a personal relationship, with continuous prayer and reading and studying of His Word and knowing His promises, then will we know how to depend on God. Otherwise, we think we can be self-sufficient. We need to be God-dependent, to depend on the Holy Spirit to guide us in everything we do. Billy Graham, America's greatest evangelist, said, "Every time my parents prayed for their sons and daughters, they were declaring their dependence on God for the wisdom, strength, and courage to stay in control of life, no matter what circumstances might bring." The world has come to depend on God, whether believers or non-believers, because of the COVID-19 pandemic. They have come to go to God in prayer, to pray for God to resolve what the world is suffering from. Action speaks louder than words. If we want our faith to be convincing to our children, we need to show evidence of our walk with God in obedience. For example, in a courtroom, to convince the judge and jury of the truth in a case, evidence and witnesses have to be produced. Paul, in 2 Timothy 3:14, described Timothy as becoming convinced of his faith from those he learned it from. And those are his grandmother, Lois, and mother, Eunice. Timothy must have witnessed his grandmother and mother living out their faith to be convinced. Convincing faith requires unconditional love. In John 13, 34-35, Jesus says, "Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples." To be convincing to our children of our faith, we must show unconditional love to them, as how Christ has shown his unconditional love to us. Christ died for us while we were still sinners. More often than not, parents' love is conditional on the children's behavior, performance, personality, and even physical looks. We must show unconditional love to our children regardless of who they are and whatever age they are. I think back of my own children when they were young, in the growing up years, and even now, when I feel like stringing them upside down, I remind myself of the unconditional love of Christ, and I need to show this unconditional love back to them. A convincing faith also requires ready forgiveness. In Colossians 3:13, Paul and Timothy wrote, "Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you have a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you." We must be ready to forgive offenses quickly in the family. If we sin against one another with words or actions, be ready to apologize. If others sin against us, be ready to forgive. Unforgiveness breeds bitterness, which causes brokenness in families. Bitterness is embedded in many families today. It is vital to build a culture of forgiveness. Children are watching to learn to forgive or be bitter. Children will be convinced that though parents are not perfect, their walk with God is real when they love unconditionally and readily forgive. A convincing faith also requires promotion of unity. Unconditional love and ready forgiveness will usher unity in a family. United families are strong families. United we stand, divided we fall. Strong families will make strong churches because the church is made up of families. Can you imagine how quickly God's kingdom or God's church will grow if the church comprises unified families obedient to the great commandments of loving God and loving one another and to the great commission of making disciples? Susanna Wesley, mother of John and Charles Wesley, is known as the mother of Methodism, said, "There are two things about the gospel, believe it and behave it." Susanna Wesley unwaveringly disciplined home life set an example of holy living that impacted many generations. And believing the gospel is remaining in Christ, and behaving the gospel will make our faith convincing. Let us look at another angle of what was expressed by Paul to Timothy. Another way of looking at Timothy's convinced faith is that he was convinced by Paul of the gospel because he was taught the Holy Scriptures from infancy. And the Holy Scriptures taught by Eunice, who was a Jew, would be from the Old Testament. And that prepared him for salvation, believing in Christ Jesus, as stated in 2 Timothy 3:14-15. A convinced faith requires early coaching, teaching and training by mothers or parents. In 2 Timothy 3:15, Paul clearly says that Timothy was taught from infancy the Holy Scriptures. Charles Spurgeon, a great Baptist preacher, said, "In my early youth, no teaching ever made such an impression upon my mind as the instruction of my mother." And John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, as many of us know, said, "You should particularly endeavor to instruct your children early, plainly, frequently, and patiently." Both mothers of Charles Spurgeon and John Wesley played pivotal roles in their lives in their early years. Mothers, teach your children when they are young, as children have a great capacity of absorbing information and learning, especially up to 12 years old. Infancy is between birth and 1 to 2 years old, and childhood is from 1 to 2 years old to 12 or 13 years old. Everyone's development pace varies, but it is a fact that the early years of childhood are marked by enormous strides in understanding and use of language. As some say, from 0 to 5 years old, children are like sponges. Because Eunice was Jewish, it would have been Paul who introduced Timothy to Christianity. Timothy would have been easily convinced of the truth of the gospel, which is about salvation in Christ, because of his earlier training and coaching from his mother and grandmother. Charles Spurgeon said, "Fathers and mothers are the most natural agents for God to use in the salvation of their children, because parents are part of God's redemption plans in the family." A connecting and convincing faith becomes contagious to our children. Parents can influence their children with their faith and become role models, setting examples for them to follow. Habits are caught more than taught. Children see, children do. Family altars, family mission trips, and families serving together are channels for role modeling to take place for families. If we don't live it, we cannot teach it. Billy Graham said, "The influence of a mother upon the lives of her children cannot be measured. They know and absorb her example and attitudes when it comes to questions of honesty, temperance, kindness, and industry. A contagious faith requires bearing fruit. In John 15:8, Jesus said, "This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." Like any fruit which has seeds, whether one like a mango or more like a papaya, the seeds when planted will become more fruit trees. Bearing fruit implies multiplication. In the context of what Jesus was teaching, fruit bearing is becoming disciples to make more disciples. The apple doesn't fall far from the trees. Children will not be very much different from their parents if their parents' faith is contagious. Bearing fruit can be seen in how our children turn out. In Timothy's case, Timothy became a co-worker of Paul during his missionary travels and became the first bishop of Ephesus. Charles Spurgeon became a great Baptist preacher, known as Prince of Preachers, preached 3,600 sermons to 10 million people. John Wesley became the founder of Methodism, preached to nearly a million people. Charles Wesley wrote 9,000 hymns, of which many are still being sung today. A contagious faith requires praying unceasingly. Unceasing doesn't mean 24/7, non-stop, but it means constantly recurring. We can't be perfect parents, but we can be praying parents. Susanna Wesley prayed 1 hour a day for her children with her prayer apron. We know the famous story of her prayer apron when Susanna Wesley puts her apron over her head, it means she is praying for her children. And she spends 1 hour a day praying for her 19 children. Prayer increases faith and shows our dependence on God. Billy Graham, who preached to live audiences of 210 million in 185 countries, said, "I am sure one reason that the Lord has directed and safeguarded me through the years was the prayers of my father and mother." In conclusion, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, revive family discipleship at home so that the faith is passed on to the next generation. The home must partner the church to disciple the future generations. Charles Spurgeon said, "We deeply want a revival of domestic religion. How can we see the kingdom of our Lord advance when his own disciples do not teach his gospel at home?" This was said in the 19th century, and it still applies today. Asian parents are most concerned about leaving an inheritance for their children. As Christian Asian parents, the more important thing for us to do is to leave a legacy of intergenerational discipleship, when young people will fear, love, and serve God, live in obedience to His word, and who will do great things for our Lord and have wholesome families of their own. Parents, go back to basics of discipling your children, yourself, at home, with a sincere faith, which is connecting, convincing, and contagious. Be parents on mission to make disciples for Christ. In closing, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I would like to invite everyone to join in a prayer adapted from Susanna Wesley's prayer. Let us pray. Help me, Lord, to remember that religion is not to be confined to the church or closet, nor exercised only in prayer and meditation, but everywhere I am in your presence. So may every word and action of mine have moral content. May all happenings of my life prove useful and beneficial. May all things instruct me and afford an opportunity of exercising some virtue and daily learning and growing towards your likeness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Faith, so she'll be safe.